My name is Pertti Hakkarainen. I'm a psychologist, psychotherapist, and I work in Helsinki prison in Finland. Thank you very much for inviting me here. Why am I here? First of all, because Nina couldn't come, so that's why I'm here. I'm the substitute. But I've been working with sex offenders since 1999, when we first introduced the STOP program in the Finnish prison system. And I was leading that at that time, and then afterwards I've been giving counseling and training STOP workers, and also meeting a lot of sex offenders in my career. And then now we have this new program called Uusi Suunta, which means new direction, new way. And I do that all the time. So first of all, I'm a clinician, I'm a practitioner. But I strongly believe that whenever we do something, we should know the theoretical basis or the basic ideas behind that. And this is what my presentation will be about. It's a little bit more. It's a little bit more than just about Uusi Suunta, but let's see. I will present to you the entity or the whole system that we have in the prison in the Finnish correctional services nowadays for sex offenders. We have few methods, and we try to offer a suitable help for different kinds of people, different in ways of reoffending risk, and in ways of what kind of help people can benefit from. I think none of our clinicians or practitioners have any training in sexology, but we lean on theory and manuscripts. So what we do usually is that we have this kind of manual to follow, that somebody has thought these things over. This is the manual for Uusi Suunta, and I would say about half of it's theory, and the other half it's the sessions. So, and we try to be precise on what we offer. So our aim is to help people to lower the reoffending risk and to build a better life after the sentence. And we even say it out loud that we don't even aim to change anyone's sexual preferences, for example, because we think that's too much for us. We would give that work to somebody else who knows it better, who has better time. This is to start with the offenders. We start with very practical things. How would you not offend again? How would you not come to prison again? How would you not harm other people again? And how does that connect to your life in a bigger sense? So risk need receptivity or responsivity principle, like we already heard today, is one of the main principles, and the other one is to build a good life. We mainly have four different methods. The STOP program, which is the heavy thing. We have four people here from Riihimäki prison. Would you like to raise your hands or something? They do this. That's the intensive program for medium and high-risk offenders. It lasts up to 9 months and has 3 to 5 sessions each week. So it's an intensive program. And this was the first one that we adopted from England and Wales in 1999. They still have that. They are now planning on have a new program, and we're waiting on that to maybe renew our program also. Then this is for the middle and high-risk offenders, a long group-based program. Then we have Uusi Suunta, New Direction, which is an individual program, 16 sessions, and this is for the low and medium-risk offenders. So as you can see, with these two programs, we, if we consider reoffending risk, we aim to cover the whole range from low to high. Because research shows that if you use the same methods for everybody, if you use the high-risk methods for low-risk offenders, you can actually increase the risk. So, as you know from the risk principle, I don't go through it again because it was already explained here. Then medication, like allojurilo showed you in the first presentation, but this has not been popular inside our prisoner population. Only one person has started medication. And then, like myself, we have psychologists who are trained psychotherapists, so this can be also considered as part of the rehabilitation. Some people use all of these methods. We have examples of people who have gone through the STOP program, the heavy intensive program, and then for a booster or another angle, another viewpoint for that same problem or same things, they go through the Uusisuunta, the New Direction program, to enforce what they have learned, get new ideas, how to build my life and so on. I will go on to those a bit later. And of course, in my opinion, medication is always a support. It's always something that supports the decisions that you make, the choices that you make. Medication, in my viewpoint, it doesn't change a person. You are, in a way, what you are by deciding what you want to do, and medication can support you in that, but it doesn't change you. Of course, there are other opinions, but I just say that I wouldn't count on medication too much because that's a cheap way, marketed very heavily by the medical industry, but that's not the truth about people. That's not the way we see people as being just biological things. But it can be a very good support, so I'm not anti-medication, but it's not the answer. Few words about the STOP program. So you get the hang of what we do, what we actually in concretely to do with people. During the 9 months that these people spend in Riihimäki prison, they have a group of 6 to 7 men, and they have 170 hours or 85 group sessions of cognitive behavioral program aiming to reduce their reoffending. I will come later about what cognitive means in this program and what behavioral means in this program. But these men meet 3 to 5 times a week to discuss 3 main themes. First thing is to find out what led me to this offense. What kind of thoughts, what kind of actions, what kind of ways of thinking, what kind of ways of seeing the world, seeing, for example, children, seeing sexuality and so on. What kind of ways of trying to cope with my feelings, trying to feel good in my life. What of these ways have a connection to what I did? So we start with the offense, and that's the reference point to almost everything that we talk about. How does this relate to what you did? If we change this or this, can it help you not to reoffend again? So it's a very practical tool in that sense. Victim empathy is another theme. There's a lot of variation in skills and using these skills of victim empathy among the sex offenders that we meet. And the most important and the longest and biggest part is building a better future in the sense of building a crime-free future with new thought and action patterns. So how should I think, how should I act if I want a different kind of result, if I want a different kind of life. The STOP program has quite a long history in Finland already, so it started in 1999 and moved to Riihimäki prison in 2007. And the numbers that we run now is we have two groups running at the same time with six tutors and one psychologist leading the STOP work. And as I already mentioned, probably this is, we have been quite satisfied with this program. It's been with us for 17 years now, but we are following with a great interest the renewals that they are doing in England. Basically aiming to target the same areas, but in a more positive way, in a, which would be more motivating for the offenders. Yeah, the same themes, but if we used to ask, what kind of dysfunctional social connections do you have? Now we start to ask how, what kind of functional, and can we make it better for you? What kind of functional social? For example, or another example, if we talk about sexuality, when we used to ask, what kind of distorted thinking do you have? Or now we're trying to ask it in a, the same question, but from the other angle. What would be a good way to think about this if you aim to live a good life? Just speaking about the same things, not avoiding the subject about sexuality, about harmful sexuality, but coming from an angle that would be more motivating for a person. As it has been said here a few times, if you want to help people to change, you really need to take them with you to change and start with this, do you want to change? These are the sessions, most of them in Finnish, but the main idea you can see also in English, that you have a 5 to 6 sessions about how did I end up doing an offense? What are the reoccurring patterns in my offenses, in my thinking that leads to them? In my mood, in my ways of acting, and so on. That's one part. The second part about victim empathy, to understand more and to be able to look at that angle of what does this mean to the victim. Because many people, there are roughly said two kinds of people in our programs. People who don't have victim empathy, not much for anyone, and people who actually have a lot of empathy, but their motivation to have something for themselves blinds this empathy about their victims. But anyways, the middle session about victim empathy, and then the future me alternatives for the offenses, future me practicing, how would I act in a similar kind of situation? So this is the very basic and quite simple idea. You have done something, can we learn something from it? And that's also one way of trying to work around the denial, that you can work with the fact that this is what has happened. So let's look at that in a neutral way, in a non-judgmental way, in a way that would call you to work with us. That's very important. That I would say the first thing that I learned working with sex offenders is that when you find a neutral viewpoint yourself, non-judgmental, not too emotional, but still empathic, then you can work with this issue as with any other issue. But it takes a bit clicking in your head, because as Andres said here, I also believe that even though we may not be that religious ourselves, but our the church and the religion, it's a mirror of our culture, and none of us are we all have a connection to that, and that connection can influence us, even though we are not aware of it. Okay. So, cognitive behavioral. That has been the mode for the fashion for psychological changing for 15, almost 20 years now. But what does it mean here? It means that you recognize the thoughts and thinking that lead to doing something, and then you change that, and you change also what you do. That's the way we explain this very simply, even though the people who are in the groups. We look at what you did, we want to talk about your thoughts, or because you first you think, then you act. Okay. Results. I think this is usually the case, that good programs can lower the recidivism or reoffending rate to half from the base rate, to half from where it started from. And we have very good results so far. Of those who finished the STOP program, the recidivism rate is 5.5. Allo had 6.5, but we have so small numbers that it changes very easily. So, and people who come to this program, they need to have a higher risk than 10%. And those who reoffend, they have a significantly higher risk, usually more than 25. So from 25 we can come to, or 15, 10 we can come to 5.5. So to us it shows that it's reasonably good. However, in a very recent study, Sasutuni found no statistically significant effect on this program. But also he said that this is probably mainly because the base rate for reoffending of sexual offenses is actually very low anyway. So the change is not that big. And the number of people, they are quite low. So in these 15 years, 250 men. And of those, 218 have been released, so they have had the possibility to reoffend. And 12 of these 218 men have recidivated or reoffended with a sexual offense. And as Alo said earlier, for other crimes, almost three times of this amount. Yeah. So, the scientific study said that we see no significant effect, but we, with these numbers, we still keep this program and believe it, that it has the effect. Another thing is that sexual offenses can be considered serious offenses in that sense that it causes serious psychological harm to the victims. So this gives another reason to continue, even though the drop is not bigger than this. Okay. Then a little bit more about uusi suunta, or new direction. A little bit about the history. A colleague, psychologist Nina Nurminen, who's a senior lecturer in our training school for criminal sanctions services, she developed this in 2012 and 2013, this individual program, which kind of follows the basic idea of the STOP program, but it also adds very significantly the good lives model and the desistance approach to it. So offenders work on their thinking about their offenses and very much on their life goals in general. And I will come more to that just now. So this new uusi suunta kind of combines the old R&R thinking with the good lives model thinking and of desistance approach. I open these words to you a little bit. So in risk need responsivity, we aim to find the risk factors that link to and lead to offending, or which still support offending. and find ways both to control these risk factors and find new solutions. So this we still have in the new direction, Uusi Suunta. Then another viewpoint is this desistance from crime. The way I understood it is it's this basic principle of that you can desist yourself, you can move away from crime for different reasons that you have come into doing crime. So what would be a good example? Substance abuse may have been one of the reasons that you have made different kind of crimes. It may have kept you in that kind of scene. But if you find a good job, that can take you away from it, even though it doesn't connect straight to the substance abuse problem. But you motivate yourself, you start to see yourself as a different kind of person. You start to, instead of a heavy drinker or a wild party animal, you start to see yourself as a hard worker or a family man. You identify yourself in a different way, and that can help you change your life. But I would say, in my viewpoint, this desistance viewpoint, it's an addition to this, that we don't want to just look at the risks, because people don't want to work with this is my risk, avoid it, avoid it, avoid it. This is, it's not so motivating. But if you start to look at your what's going to be good in my life, what's going to be better in my life, that's more motivating. And this takes us to the Good Lives model. In the Good Lives model, the basic idea is that each person, every one of us, aims for our primary life goals. And these primary life goals are universal and they are always good. I will show you a list of these goals. So instead of seeing a person as a So a person can try to reach these primary goals also with wrong means, for example, with crime. So instead of seeing a person as having a personality disorder and or perversion and in this way sick, we see this person as another person like us, trying to reach for a good life, but doesn't really know how, tries with the wrong means, you know. One very, very typical example of this is one motivating factor for sex offenses can also be a need to be close to other persons. You just want to be close to someone. You want tenderness, connection, and so on. And this is a good way. This is a good goal that we all know we all need. But some people have not learned these good ways. Their history, developmental history, may be such that they have never learned any good ways to do this. Or they have not learned boundaries about this. So they try to connect with, for example, with children, if they really don't know how to connect with adults, and they do not see this boundary, or they see this is the only way to get at least some of this connection with another person. But the main thing here is the different angle that you see. If I put it really simple, that we used to say that you are bad in this way, and this as your risk, you should change. And now we say something like this, that we are all trying to be very good, and you are also. But let's find ways how to do that without harming others. Because these ways that you have done, it harms people. It causes suffering, as you can see here in the victim part. Okay. I'll show you this. So here are, of course, these can be very debatable. This is, you can never build a complete list of what we as humans want in our life, but this is some kind of a list. And we everybody aims by acting in a certain way to achieve an individual combination of these primary goals. Like for somebody, it can be very important that they, the number seven, relatedness, that they relate to other people. And for somebody it can be, for the same person, it can be that for him it's very important that he has this excellence in work. So he's a, people see him as a good worker and so on. And maybe if you would add to this combination that a person would have number 10, that feeling good in here and now, this pleasure element would be very important for him. And this person would be unemployed, depressed and feeling detached from other people, because work has been very important for him. This can, in a way, and he, actually this is a case of mine that I work with, that he was unemployed and then things were not going so well with his wife. So he didn't feel related to anyone. He didn't feel the self-worth that he got from work. And also number five, that he didn't feel the autonomy that he will direct his own life. And with this combination, he ended up having sex with his own daughter, who was in her puberty, and in that way coming to a sexually active age. So this man kind of wanted to have this relatedness, feeling of self-worth, and got this admiration from her own daughter, but couldn't see in his situation these boundaries, that this is not the right way for me to try to reach these things. And he was very regretful afterwards. But when he came and we started to go through this, he didn't really have no idea. It was a big shame for him that this had happened, and it was a big mystery for him. But kind of, and it was not easy for him to see that there was anything good that he tried to. He had this solution that he said that Satan came into me, I came possessed, and he was a religious man, so that's why I did it. But at least we saw it that if this is his solution, then the reoffending risk may stay quite high, because he doesn't have any means to stop the Satan coming again or whatever. So it was not easy for him to start to look at these things like this, but we found this combination of that he wanted to feel self-worth, he wanted to feel that he has some control in his life, and he wanted to feel loved. And even though he was out of work, now an ex-prisoner, and he still had some problems with his wife, he saw that there should be other ways of building this than falling into pleasure, as kind of giving into that idea of finding pleasure with any cost. Yeah, but you get the basic idea. So in Uusi Suunta, you talk about what happened. This is kind of two things here, really. You try to go around the denial in this sense that when you can say out loud that this is what happened, it can also be a big relief. And we're trying to find some common ground in that, okay, what do you think happened? And this is what the court explanations say. And then we look at what do you want to work here with? So we set goals for working. We actually have this program and we say, this is the program and this is what we do. But let's see what are the important things here for you. Part B is kind of comes after that, if you can say out loud that this is what I did, this is what happened, then you come to the part why and what was it all about. Because it can be about sex, it can be about sexual interest, but usually it's about many other things also. And sometimes it doesn't really have that much to do with sexual interest. Not like Alo said, and many presenters here have said, not all people who have sex with children are really interested primarily on children. It's connectedness, pleasure, whatever we seek from other people. But anyway, we try to increase awareness of factors relating to offending. What motivated me? How did I act? How did my social surroundings supported me in this way, or how did everything affect this? And this is about the half of the program, from 1 to 8, what happened and why. And then the last half is what is needed to do not to offend, the new direction of my life. And with this basic idea, we try to look, what were you looking for when you did this? What did you, what's all that you wanted from this offense? This is not an easy subject, but when you get used to it, talking about it yourself, you can really help other people talk about it, just with your attitude. If you're not afraid of to talk about it, if you bring some kind of empathy when you talk about it, then it's so much easier for another person to talk about it also. So it's very important for us to know what were the motivations behind this. And then the last part is, okay, how can we reach for these same goals, but not in a harmful way, in a harmful way. And throughout the program, when you look at your own thinking, your own ways of acting, you increase your own skills to look at yourself and also to intervene in your own thoughts. So sometimes people just say that it just happened. I don't know what I thought. There's no explanation. It just happened. This may be more often the case with violent offenses, but also with sex offenses, in my experience. But if you can find something there, why did it happen, it increases your skills to direct yourself, not just react to things, but think, plan, and do what you want. And also solve problems. If things don't go like you want, how can I solve this? For example, if I would say, let's take me for an example, if I would look at this list, I would say, for me, number 7 is very important in my life. I feel that relating to other people is very important to me. Yes, number 4, excellence in work, that gives something to my self-esteem. I would say spirituality in some sense is also very important for me. If I can look at these things and then look at how do I try to achieve these goals, how do these goals affect my life, then I can go more efficiently towards those goals. But surprisingly, we are not so used to do this, because the feeling that we usually get is something just happened, it came into my mind and then I acted on it. But if we become more aware, we have these skills to become more aware of what we are thinking, where is it leading, then we have more control over our life. This is the basic idea. Okay, if you think about STOP program, 250 men have been through it in 15 years. New direction, because we can implement it in so many more places with more people. 50 to 7 persons go through the program yearly. Of course, it's also so much shorter. It's 16 sessions instead of 85. But this is the thing that we have now, and it will probably continue like this. This seems to be the, in Finnish correctional services, that 57 persons go through this new direction program every year. So in 10 years, we should have a good basis for research. 500 to 700 persons who have been through this. Just a few words about medication. I actually already said all this, so so a few conclusions of all I think have been said here already. We can affect sex offenses. We can lower the offending rate. But not just doing something, we need to look at carefully what we do and implement that. Do it in practice very good. Like in Estonia, a program won't help you if you don't support that program, if you don't find the good people to do that. So the implementation is very important. And I would say in our experience, that can you can forget that sometimes. Okay, yes, we have the program, but the people who do the program are the program. So support them, give them education, let them learn more, and support them all the time, because sometimes you can go wrong. You do something and you, in the middle of it all, you don't see the big picture. So counseling for those who do it, it's very important in two ways. So somebody can see, ask the question, what are you doing and why? And then you can see if you start to react to the themes. Because you can also get traumatized by listening to these stories day in and day out. No, we see no contradiction in linking risk-need principle with a good lives model and desistance. So try to find the best of the things that are available. So, yeah, that's it.